as it's written, and trust that site plan review will provide the appropriate opportunity to review and comment on the applicant's designs.
Okay. Is there other discussion? At this point, there has already been a public hearing, and I sense some interest in the public to address this. We have the opportunity of a number of different things to consider sending this on to the town council. Perhaps have another hearing, although I think we have, through the workshop process, we've had one public hearing on the issue already. If there's no further discussion, can we entertain a motion? Go ahead, Judy.
Propose the following. Be it ordered that the Planning Board recommends to the Town Council the proposed amendments to Section 19-1-3, 19-3-1E, 19-3-5-2V, and 19-2-4 of the Zoning Ordinance relating to recreational and athletic facilities in accordance with Section 19-4-9 of the Zoning Ordinance.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to as read. Is there any further discussion on the motion? Seeing none, those in favor of the motion as read, and raise your right hand. Opposed? It's the unanimous vote. The third item on the agenda this evening is the Affordable Housing Ordinance requiring affordable housing in residential developments and amendments to Section 19-3-12, Section 19-4-9. Again, this has been an ongoing saga of the Planning Board developing a affordable housing ordinance, and thanks to our planner, our past planner and our new planner, we've come quite a distance, I'd say, in developing an ordinance. At this time, I'd ask the planner to briefly review the changes to update and then make mention to the board perhaps what our next what directions we can take for that.
From the comments in the last meeting, there have been some minor changes and some major changes. Some of the major changes to the draft that you have in front of you are that the definition of moderate income has been redefined to include persons of median income up to 150% of median income in the metropolitan statistical area of Portland, as opposed to just the town of Cape Elizabeth. Another major change has been a revision of the proposal for density bonuses for subdivisions that provide affordable housing. The reduced lot size in the RC zone has gone down to 8,000 square feet, and the reduced lot size in the RA zone has gone down to 30,000 square feet. The option for the board at this time, because the proposal before you amends portions of the zoning ordinance, public hearing is required prior to any action or recommendation to the council. So what you could be doing tonight would be recommending this for public hearing scheduling, or you may want to bring it back to another workshop for further review and comment.
Any discussion, comments, or questions from the board?
I think it would be helpful to have a public hearing so that we could get the public's input, particularly with respect to lot size.
I think so. Is there some special way we could get this out into the public? So I'd like to see as much feedback from the public as possible. We've spent a lot of time. Sometimes I sense there's very little interest in affordable housing. Other times I get bombarded with the question. We've been meeting at workshop level mostly with almost no feedback, and I think it's time, and I would agree with Tom, it's time to get some good feedback. I would say, just in one comment of my own, I made it known the last couple of workshops, my initial disagreement with Section 19.3.17 in the proposing 10% of any subdivision to be affordable housing and some of the social economic aggravation that can cause in a real estate economy. Having read this through numerous times, I am beginning to disagree with myself. I think that it's very possible that this can be done in an acceptable way. It does not, you immediately think of one out of every 10 homes has to be an affordable home stuck in the middle. I think the proposed ordinance that we have out gives lots of different options that all aims toward the same effect, and that is that we provide for the town 10% of all the new units being developed are affordable. Are there other comments, concerns from the board?
I would, if I could reiterate what you've said, I don't know of anything that we've worked on as long as this, that I have been from one end of the spectrum to the other and back, and then I'm still trying to find where I want it. I would really like to have some public input. We talked at the last workshop, and I do think we need another workshop. I'm still working this over in my own mind. But we had talked at the last workshop of trying to get something in the paper in a larger sort of thing than just, meeting on mm-hmm. Tuesday night, that there's this, that there are certainly, if nothing more than the interest that would be stimulated by affordable housing in Cape Elizabeth, and that mm-hmm. was such an animal. And how do you do it? And it is possible, which I didn't think there was a year and a half ago, to do this. But I'd love to hear what people think.
Perhaps our planner could help some type of press release or news release to help gain some interest in a public hearing. It seems to be a consensus that a public hearing is an appropriate thing. Do I hear a motion to that effect? Go ahead, anybody. Don't be bashful.
Be it ordered that the proposed affordable housing ordinance be tabled to February 19th, 1991, meeting of the Planning Board, when a public hearing will be held in accordance with Section 19-4-9 of the zoning ordinance.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Do I hear any discussion, further discussion on the motion? Hearing and seeing none, ask for a vote. All those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's unanimous vote. At this time, with the arrival of Jim Kay, I will ask that Tom Emery stay on as a voting member, and Judy step down for this one. Willing, perhaps we'll swap on the next one. We'll leave you on, Judy. Don't want to leave anybody out. The next order of business on the agenda, if I can find it. Elizabeth Heights Retirement Community, construction of 60-unit congregate care facility located on the Scott Dyer Road, site plan review, section 19-2-9 and 19-3-15. If the applicant could come to the podium and identify themselves, and give us a very brief, concise update. Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Dan Horahan. You know that very well by now, I should say, but I'm here on behalf of First Atlantic, and to make it brief and concise, at our last meeting, we had a public hearing on our project, 60 units of independent living congregate housing on Scott Dyer Road. After that meeting, we received a letter from town planner Maureen O'Mara, which outlined a number of issues or items that needed to be addressed prior to this meeting. On January 4th, we sent the planning board a submission which contained a breakdown of the items that were either addressed by the board verbally at that prior meeting or by Maureen. Summarize quickly, we met with the abutters and we feel we've come up with a final buffering plan which addresses everybody's needs as well as addresses the needs of the environment. We did get our final market study, which we attached to that submission, which showed that there is a need for this type of project in the area. It backed up our earlier market study that we did a number of years ago. We've agreed to extend the sidewalk as requested by the town. I understand that the easement language which we submitted needs to be reviewed by the planner and the town council. You know, we're hoping that that feedback will be positive, and as a result of any comments, we can change that accordingly. We also submitted a shadow analysis of the project with that January 4th submission as requested by this board. We submitted a visual simulation showing trees without leaves. We submitted a new lighting plan. I also understand that the tree warden has issued some comments regarding the protection of the 24-inch elm tree, which is on Scott Dyer Road. And we intend to do whatever is possible to protect that tree and to fulfill the requirements of the tree warden. There's also a comment by the town engineer regarding a culvert size of 6 inches versus 12 inches. And in the area of that tree, I think the tree warden would rather see it 6 inches. We're willing to work with you. Obviously, we'd like to have as minimal impact as possible on that tree. We wouldn't want to disrupt the root system, so we would be willing to live with a 6-inch culvert. To summarize, you know, we've been before you a number of times over the years, and I think right now we're at the point where we have a project that works for everybody. We met with DEP between the last meeting and this evening to go over all the issues regarding site plan review and an NRPA permit. We met with two separate departments of DEP. They've both given their opinion that we do not need to be reviewed by them. So at this point, you know, with me tonight is our team, our engineer, Mark Gray, Will Polger, the architect, and Frank Cushing, the landscape architect, and we're here to answer any questions you might have regarding the specifics of the submission. But, you know, I would request tonight that we would be granted site plan approval with the condition that we would work out the items enumerated in the memo before you that was drafted by the town planner. We feel that those are all issues that can be dealt with very easily on an administrative basis. And given the time we've put into it, the time the town's put into the project, you know, I ask that, you know, we be given approval this evening.
Thank you, Mr. Ryan.
Thank you.
Questions, comments from the planning board?
Go ahead, Judy.
I think I'll run down Maureen's memo. Under item one, circulation, talks about the 5-foot wide sidewalk, and those yards in the Elizabeth Park, 3-4 houses, I don't remember, are very small, and I wondered if it's possible that I don't know if this is even reasonable, if the sidewalk decrease in width as it approaches those houses to match the sidewalk on the other side of Longfellow Drive. I don't think that's a 5-foot sidewalk. And since those people aren't here, I assume they would appreciate losing as little of their yard if that would satisfy the town requirements. I don't know that it would.
Is that where it matches into, I believe it's the end of, there's a little spur of Longfellow?
Well, there's an existing sidewalk that runs down from the school and ends at Longfellow.
Okay.
And then I understand the applicant would be matching with the proposed one for the Viking, which I assume is a 5-foot sidewalk. But I was just wondering if perhaps on either as it approaches the houses or maybe from, I don't even know what direction, the easterly side of the access drive, if that could be narrowed. It might not meet town codes, but that's a suggestion.
I don't know. Does the town have a code standard for sidewalks?
Public Works Director has requested that the sidewalk be 5 feet wide. However, it will encroach, and you can correct me, Frank, if I'm wrong, but it'll encroach on the yards less than the existing sidewalk will, because there will be no esplanade between the sidewalk and the road. There'll be a curb and then the sidewalk. So it actually will be further away from those yards than the existing one is now.
Okay, I don't have concerns about that. Mm-hmm. I'll go ahead and go on.
Mm-hmm.
Under the next paragraph deals with the parking places and indicates that the applicant would want to build less than is required right now, with the provision, if that's not adequate, they would put in the remainder. That parking requirement is under the section for housing for the elderly. Does the planning board have specific authority to waive in that section, or is it anywhere in the zoning ordinance that we can waive those kinds of requirements?
Well, it's not specifically a waiver. I would argue it's not specifically a waiver, because the applicant has indicated on the plan that they're where the additional parking spaces would be placed. Perhaps a waiver would be needed at the time before the building is occupied, or before the expiration of the time. On the plan, there's a note that says that 6 months after occupancy, there would be a determination made by the code enforcement officer whether or not those spaces could be put in. It's possible that at that time, a waiver would have to be requested.
Okay.
Also on that, Maureen, correct me if I'm wrong. If we choose to make this the 6 month site check by the code enforcement officer, that presently is not a condition?
Actually, it's a note on the plan, so if the board approves the plans, that goes along with it.
Okay.
Skimming down the memo, on, you've remarked under number 3, building and parking area design and layout, that the fire lane is proposed right now to be gravel base with loam. Fire chief has recommended that it be paved. If it's paved, is there any noticeable change in runoff calculations that we would need to be concerned about?
Well, that brings up a good issue. We were hoping to revise that condition to have language in there that said that as long as the surface met the requirement of the fire chief, that would be an appropriate condition. And you know, that would be something that I suppose we could negotiate with the fire chief, depending on his needs. On the run, we would rather not pave it. And I'm assuming that any surface that would be required as a condition would be dependent upon the fire chief's assessment of the situation. So we were hoping to talk to him to work that issue out. As far as runoff, I don't know. I guess I'd have to pass that over to Mark Graham.
I'm Mark Graham with BH2M Engineers, and we've been retained to assist with the, among other things, the stormwater management plan. The results of our study indicated that there were two basic drainage areas or discharge areas. Those areas that were tributary to the pond, upstream of the two large culverts, and that area that's downstream. Our report.
Excuse me, sir. I'm sorry. They're not picking up on the microphone. Could you come to the microphone and address the board?
The area that is upstream of the two major culverts was the drainage patterns and the post-development condition were managed such that there was no increase in peak discharge to that particular area. Now, this requirement of the fire chief or the board, and I don't know which, to pave the fire lane around the structure will increase both the total quantity of runoff and the peak rate of runoff. However, it will have no effect on the conclusion of the report, because it is in that second tributary area that I discussed. And our report clearly indicates that the post-development discharges in that area exceed the pre-development levels, but because it discharges into the marsh, where there's a very large attenuation factor, there's literally no impact. And that conclusion was agreed to by the town's review engineer.
Murphy, I might, and I don't know if you're the appropriate person to answer, but I might ask what you might expect what the expected life of the 2 inches of loam on top of gravel would be after plowing.
As I understand it, that isn't the case now anyway. That area is going to be paved.
It is going to be paved.
Yeah, that's the recommendation. Is that correct?
I don't believe that's part of the plan, as it...
The plan does not show it to be paved.
During staff review, Mr. Webster determined that he would prefer to have that fire lane paved. And his preference is bituminous concrete. It runs entirely almost around a residential wing, and the fire lane would have to be 18 feet wide. Owing to the fact that I've got quite a population that will be living there and looking out on it, there's some decks just adjacent to it and whatnot, I'd like to have some flexibility in what that pavement would be. There are a number of pavements which are much more aesthetically pleasing than bituminous. It'll probably end up being a combination of bituminous and grasscrete pavers turf stone pavers, Mr. Webster has seen those in the town and believes they would be suitable for this purpose. So I think it's just a detail that he and I have to work out and add to the plan.
Do you or one of your engineers know whether those are constructed take the weight of a fire truck?
Yes, they will.
I guess I might just add one final question, perhaps, for Maureen. Actually, two. One has to do with the lighting, the radius of the lights that the engineers commented on a couple of times. Without that information on the plans, I assume he is somewhat confident, and are you confident that the impact of the lighting that is proposed in combination with the fences and landscape buffering will not affect the neighbors particularly much, since it's not shown on the plan?
I believe the applicant does have a plan that shows pools of light, 5-foot candles. Do you think you could flip to that?
It was submitted in January 4th.
Right. That's it. Mm-hmm.
And it does show the foot candle distribution for all of the sight lighting up there. There's no light spilling over the property line from the project. I think this was presented several times, or at least once previously, to the board. The only place where a minor light, where it gets confusing is at the stub of Longfellow Drive, where there's an existing culvert head, and we have our site lighting merging with the lighting that's already there, so that stub will be the lighted area, which is appropriate because we do have a pedestrian walkway coming up and joining with the pavement there. You also have a public lot here, which is open space, and it would provide some additional lighting or security at night or whatnot for that area.
Thank you. That's enough for now. Thank
okay.
you.
I might mention to the members of the planning board that what we have before us tonight, we can look at one of two or three different ways. To consider the site plan review with a number of conditions, to consider it suggestions to the applicant to return. I think if, as board members, you are favoring the approach that includes conditions, that you start jotting notes now in here, so that and I'm very willing to take some time when we get to that point. I know we quite often get sort of jammed up when we get to some type of decision-making time. To take your time, make sure that we've covered all of the bases. If there are questions about what in Maureen's suggestions are a part of the plan as it is now, that you ask that question. If it's not clear if that's already a condition, ask that question. I didn't mean to interrupt. Are there more questions or comments? Tom?
I have just a couple of questions. Do we have anywhere on the plans the alignment of the sidewalk beyond your property line heading toward Longfellow and its relationship to the edge of pavement and the right-of-way line?
I think it's a smaller diagram.
Drawing number C100, and you should have that in the January 4th submission. It's a 20-foot plan showing that alignment from our westerly property to its connection with Longfellow Drive at the end of the existing parking.
I'm sorry, Frank, I don't have that package with me. Could you just describe for the public what the proposal is?
Certainly. It begins adjacent to our westerly property line with a small section of sidewalk with an esplanade, crosses the our access drive, and then dips down into the property line approximately 20 feet from the center of the trunk of that elm tree, mm-hmm. to get away from the impacting on that trunk, and then returns up to Scott Dyer Road in a gentle fashion, and runs adjacent to Scott Dyer Road with an esplanade up to this plan doesn't have our home numbers. It would be home number 66, Scott Dyer, across their front lawn. In front of 66 Scott Dyer, the sidewalk does have an esplanade there. There's an existing catch basin off the edge of pavement about 3 feet into the right-of-way. It's a gravel around it now. What we would do is pave in a bituminous apron around that and skirt the sidewalk behind it and then return it up to Scott Dyer. At that point, you begin with a Cape Cod bituminous curve, no esplanade, and a 5-foot sidewalk, and that crosses the next three homes in succession, at which point the existing sidewalk, it joins the existing sidewalk really on the other side of Longfellow Drive.
And which also is a similar detail. It's
that,
right
that
along the road.
That detail is a bituminous curve, 3-foot esplanade, and a 5-foot sidewalk. We pulled it to Scott Dyer Road in order to keep it where we could, in order to keep it out of the front yards of these homes. Fortunately, there's one hedge here which we need to move back, but it's privet, and I believe we could be successful in doing that.
Did you have discussions with those homeowners in deciding where the sidewalk would be located? I understand it's within the right-of-way, but the issue is that there's a perception of what one's front yard is, and obviously the people who don't have sidewalks today, the perception is that they own out to the street edge. What I'm concerned with is that we don't have neighbors and abutters coming in who are angry because they didn't expect to see a sidewalk in their front lawn. I'm saying this with two notions in mind. To me, one of the great ways of ruining rural character in a community very quickly is to put sidewalks right on the edge of the street with no esplanades. But that sort of rural character has to be weighed with the trade-off of people having already fairly small front yards and small lots, suddenly finding a sidewalk in what appears to be the middle of their front lawn.
Mm-hmm.
I would, if you haven't had any discussions with the abutters, I would think that it would be appropriate to do so.
I haven't personally had any discussions. We, First Atlantic Corp, sent a letter to those four homeowners, and I'm unaware of any responses that you may have gotten, or whether anyone has responded to Maureen.
I did have one homeowner call me about the sidewalk, and their comment was primarily that they didn't want an esplanade because no one took care of it.
Okay.
That was one homeowner.
Second issue on lighting. Would you describe once again what the concept is behind the lighting of coming into the entrance drive? Once again, this question is taken out of the notion of rural character, whereas, for instance, within the subdivision which I live has its street lights, so to speak, are telephone poles with CMP fixtures mounted, and the lights occur at every road intersection, which in some cases is a separation of as much as more than 500 feet, and admittedly it doesn't meet any lighting design criteria that I know of, but what it does do is illuminate the intersection where there's a likelihood of automobile and pedestrian
interaction, not a lot, but a little bit of likelihood. But the streets are relatively dark, which is fairly typical of rural areas in Cape Elizabeth.
Yes.
My concern is and I'll just express my concern, then you can go ahead and state what your approach was. My concern is, as one drives down Scott Dyer Road, which is a fairly dark road, I'm concerned with the visibility and safety out of your driveway, which I think you've addressed with your lighting. But I'm concerned with sort of the rural character and looking up across that field, which was once a field, which at night could have some interesting illumination from the building sort of shimmering on the trees and looking out through the, you know, reflecting on the snow and that sort of thing. But suddenly there's this sort of marching, a very regimented marching of lights along a curvilinear entrance drive. I know that in many cases that can be quite attractive. I just don't know if it's consistent with the rural character of Cape Elizabeth.
I'm not sure it is either.
I would just suggest that I think the Cape has, in its planning process, looked at certain areas and designated them appropriate for this type of development. And going through the process where I personally worked with this board for over 2 years on the zone change and to come up with this criteria that the town deemed that it would be appropriate to allow this type of use in the RC mm-hmm. zone. So that I agree with you that most parts of the Cape, in most parts of the Cape, this wouldn't be appropriate, but I feel that we've been through the process where the town found that maybe this is the right use with the types of illumination attached to it that would be appropriate.
Well, I'm hoping I may be able to save you some money here. is your intent that there'd be a lot of pedestrians on this driveway and therefore you have a very regimented light level, or is it the interaction of pedestrians and traffic, or is there some other purpose?
What I have is the elderly population with can quite often have very poor eyesight. That throughout the design of the project, the limitations of the elderly are built into the project. One of the things that I find is required is at least a minimal amount of even sight lighting over an area. And these people will have cars and they will be driving, although not much at night, but they will drive. That is the primary reason for locating roadway lighting along that road. We were somewhat careful, or there was a good deal of consideration given to the fixture and the mm-hmm. pole. It is a more traditional fixture. It has cutoffs in it,
mm-hmm.
And it's relatively low mounted on a fiberglass pole. They're only 16-foot yep. mounting heights. I'm trying to get a blend here, or a balance going between the requirements of the elderly in lighting this roadway and something that would fit in fairly well. But I understand what you're saying about the character of the field and illuminating it. It's one of the things we're butting up against here, I guess.
Let me ask you another question then. Is it your intention that these will be dusk to dawn fixtures, or are they on a timer?
They certainly could be on a timer. We have not detailed it that far. Another point that I'd like to make is that if we get any less lighting on there, I'm not sure I can find an electrical engineer to stamp
exactly.
the plan. Mm-hmm. I've been over it a number of times. We've been through a couple of scenarios mm-hmm. for sight lighting. I think it's about as minimal as I feel comfortable putting on there.
We would like to work with a timer, I think, just in the interest of saving.
I think that would be a good idea.
I
don't see any reason to drive down a street at, a rural street in Cape Elizabeth at 3 in the morning. Not that I do that very often, but to find the lights on. And we found out that all our commercial buildings are shining bright at night at 3 in the morning. I don't know why, but...
No, you're right.
Now, could you describe for us once again what you have done with respect to the buffer, the meetings that you have had with the neighbors, and your interpretation of where we stand now in terms of the buffering of the properties?
There was an invitation to meet at the office of First Atlantic, issued, I believe it was the week after our last planning board meeting.
to come and voice any concerns. At that time, I sat with whoever cared to come and talk to us about buffering between their homes and discuss their needs and wants. Those people that did respond to us, I've incorporated those responses into the plan. The following day, I also made two site visits to get a better feel from inside a house what they were looking out at. Basically, there's, you may well remember, the landscaping concept of the buffer changes in a couple places along the property line. The most impacted property owners are those pretty much in this sector. Mm-hmm. We had planned a very thorough evergreen buffer, and it was relatively close to the property line. After discussions, what is important to them, and they do not want to lose, is the orientation of views to the marsh. So conceptually, in that sector, the evergreen buffer was consolidated and pushed closer to the building to leave a previews for homes up to number 33. There were several other requests. Home number 29 did not want evergreen trees, but wanted some lower level screening, so we changed the evergreen trees to a combination of junipers and taxes. And there was another home in this area which requested the malus that were transplanting to be moved close to the property line, which we've also incorporated that in this area. Also on this plan, which has not been on a previous plan, is some fencing and hemlock plantings adjacent to the road between home number 11 and home number 13. That's the gist of what we've done, and I don't know what else to say other than we've picked up whatever they've requested or their ideas or concepts were for that landscape and incorporated it in here.
During our last site walk, you'd introduced the notion of working closely with the neighbors, and that during installation of the vegetation,
yes,
there could be fine-tuning of that. In your opinion, does a plan that you've presented tonight fairly represent what you would expect the neighbors also understand to be the case? The reason I raise this, Frank, is the concern I have is that you, once we've signed a document here, that you don't end up, either you or the neighbors don't end up in shouting match or in confrontation or contentious situation on site because people have misunderstandings. And the only way that we as a board understand what you are to provide and what the neighbors understand is going to be provided is the documentation we have in front of us. So if you feel, it sounds as though from your description that you've followed through with what you discussed on site, and if those, what you've described is on that drawing, that's really all I need to know.
I'm very comfortable with it. We did leave that opportunity that you mentioned in an addition note 13, which gives a time period at which a resident could request an adjustment of the plant. They would be spaced on day one, notified by handbill that mm-hmm. evening, and they would have an opportunity up till noontime to make a request to the landscape architect or the landscape contractor to adjust that plant location.
Okay.
I think it would work okay.
One other comment on the shadow impacts in your supplementary material. Have any of the abutters who are affected by these shadows seen this documentation?
I don't, it's been on file since the 4th
of January.
It wasn't mailed to anyone. And we did have it for show after the last board meeting.
Have you received any comments regarding this?
I don't recall any comments on that particular item. I know a lot of the abutters knew there would be some shadow impact. I just don't remember if anyone's actually seen that particular drawing.
In case there's anyone who's either in the audience or viewing at home, we have in front of us a 11 by 17 diagram
labeled a shadow analysis, and it shows shadows for sunset on June 21st, March 1st, and December 21st. And it does show, for example, on March 1st and September 21st, which obviously is spring and fall, an extensive shadow falling across lots 33 and 35. But it's also at 5:30 p.m. and sunset on that day is at about 6 o'clock. I would imagine that the trees would cast a shadow longer than, you know, the trees would probably preempt the building shadow. And I think a similar situation would exist for the 4 o'clock on December 21st. I'm surprised there's even any sun available at that time, but just so that people don't look at this and see the shadow and get very concerned about the length of the shadow, these are extremely late afternoon times for the particular season. And the 8:30 p.m. shadow for June 21st indicates that there's no shadowing of adjacent properties. So assuming that with the tools available that those are reasonably accurate, I feel fairly comfortable with what you've shown us.
As you mentioned, they do not take into account the existing vegetation along the property lines. There are trees there, some pretty significant ones.
And one last question on the visual simulation. Could you describe briefly where that view was taken from? Could you just show on a plan where that is?
Sure. That's at the across Scottsdale Road at the high point in the road, looking directly into the site. It's almost the identical viewpoint of the same, well, of the foliated simulation that you have in the. In the full report.
Okay, thank you.
Are there other questions or comments from the planning board? I have just a couple comments. Number one, I appreciate the update of the market feasibility study. Mr. Record admits that it's not a full feasibility. It's ample information and there were a lot of facts brought to light, and I, for one, appreciate that type of information. Lastly, on my part anyway, I'd like to ask our planner to comment on the pedestrian easement, or if there's a member from the land trust here that might want to make comment on the sufficiency or the placement of the easement.
Right now on the plan, the applicant has given to the town a pedestrian easement over the existing sewer easement that's on the, I believe, the south side of the property. In addition, there is another easement which runs along the west side of the property. The applicant has given us a pedestrian easement which connects Scott Dyer Road with that other sewer easement. So there is a way to cross the entire property without going through the building. However, there was some comments from the Conservation Commission about the location of that second pedestrian easement, and Bill Wadman from the Conservation Commission is here. If you'd like to hear him describe
certainly.
It. I'm Bill Wadman from Old Colony Lane. I'm chairman of the Conservation Commission, and I feel like I may be going to the well too many times here. But there is one lingering concern that we have that I think I can indicate to you. Pedestrian easements at this point run across the southern end of the property, which serves the neighborhood of Elizabeth Park extremely well, getting to land trust land up in here that's been contributed by the Viking people. Since, however, these were laid out and we've had our discussions, this particular piece here has been conveyed to the land trust. We have a very nice access to it off the Longfellow Drive stub and across the roadway and into the easement here, and you can step onto it very nicely right here. However, you got to turn around and come back out. If we had something that tied across this way, if there is an existing walkway or trailway, that could bring us back on the sewer easement where this eventually winds up, we'd be in perfect rotation to go through there.
I don't see a problem with that. Do you, Frank?
No, actually.
There's some wetness, I know. If we could find a small island passage that would carry us back onto the sewer easement, back onto the trail, up on here.
This piece is mostly wetland, so I think that what you're looking at is skiing use mostly.
Yes, right.
That's about it. What you have on this particular easement, at present, there's a mown path.
Right.
And it runs all the way up to about this point. So I,
Is this indicated to be high enough to get to here, to that point, or is this totally wet here?
It's not wet.
Yeah.
It is walkable.
It is.
I'm pretty sure.
That would be our only concern at this point, having achieved this length, which brings us up through this way, to be able to get on this and to get off it and back onto the trail system makes it that much more usable.
Sure.
Okay? That would be fine. If that could be worked out, I think we'd be satisfied. The only other problem that I noted, and I think Maureen indicated that the covenants were going to be worked over, it does speak to motorized vehicles. There's also a nasty little implement that has big, fat rubber tires that works on pedals that are called a mountain bike. They can do an awful job on a woodland trail, and we'd like to have that kind of vehicle as well excluded from that trail system all over town. Not just this one, but everywhere that we're working on the green belt. We'd like to have so-called mountain bikes excluded. I'm not opposed to kids. I've got enough of them myself and six grandchildren, but I would expect that there are going to be people who are living in your community that are going to be using these trails as well, and we'd like to keep them as safe and as nice as we can.
Sounds reasonable.
Fine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I did have one other. I seldom can stop at just two things. But a question on circulation. And Maureen says it's a part of the plan or a note on the plan that the code enforcement officer determines that parking violations are occurring 6 months after occupancy. Are we talking about 100% occupancy or when you first start an occupancy program? My concern is that we don't know whether you're full until you're full.
Well, I was going to suggest that you probably don't know whether or not you have a parking problem until it is full.
Mm-hmm.
So that maybe it should be 6 months after the facility is full. That's a good point, because the national rate of absorption is 3 to 5 units per month. So we could get in a situation where 6 months after this building permit or after construction is completed where it is full and you really wouldn't know the impact of the market.
Yeah, I don't want to make it an overly technical condition. It's just a matter of common sense of when it reaches peak occupancy, whether it's 90% or 95% or 100%, as I'm sure you hope. I think that we need to give consideration to make that a part or a change in the condition.
No, you can. There's adequate parking here, I believe, for the facilities. In fact, I bet on it. The 6 month comes from finish up contractors. When they're building this facility, you get all kinds of vans parked around here, and I just wanted enough time before any determination was made till the contractors are off the site and you're actually in a residential situation. It may need to be a year. I don't know.
Any other questions or comments from the board?
There is one comment I did want to make regarding the DEP review. The applicant had gone to DEP to determine whether or not site location review was needed and also whether a wetlands permit would be needed. I have received a letter stating that the site location permit is not required for this project. I've also talked to the DEP person in Portland that reviews wetlands today, and there will be a letter forthcoming stating this project also doesn't need a wetlands permit.
Ivan.
Mr. Edsel, I want to thank you for taking on the chairmanship this evening.
Certainly, we're glad you're back.
Apologize for the duties at the university that kept me late. I am going to not vote on this officially, even though I do want to express my opinion on the project, only because I missed the important discussions this evening, and I think it would be unfair to vote on that basis. But I think this kind of this process that we've gone through with this applicant, I think, is noteworthy for a lot of reasons. I think that the applicant has attempted to be interested in our views and has attempted to comply to the needs that we've expressed. I also, commenting on this project itself, I know it's received a lot of neighborhood opposition, and I recognize the reasons for it. I happen to live in the area myself. But when we look at the kinds of development that we can have in town, and we look at the demographics of our population as it is aging, we have to take a look at all kinds of projects. And I think that responsible development like this is something that that we should try to welcome to the town. So while I can't vote, I just wanted to make my comments clear on the process and how I think this applicant's approached it, which I think has been noteworthy.
Thank you. I would also like to say that I appreciate the attention to our requests that Ivan mentioned and to almost every detail. It's greatly appreciated by this board member anyway. Any other comments or questions? Judy?
I have one that is minor, but we have some suggested conditions of approval, and one that hasn't been mentioned under section, I can find it here, 19-3-15, housing for the elderly, subsection D, it talks about the elderly household occupancy guarantee. It does say that this should be housing for the elderly, and this requirement shall be an express condition of approval of an applicant. I would like to have that a condition of approval to be in keeping with the ordinance. Just something of the nature of the proposed Elizabeth Heights congregate care facility shall be restricted to occupancy by elderly households. This restriction shall be included in every residence written agreement by which residents occupy the units on the facility or in the facility.
I think that's a reasonable request, and would ask that you remember to add that at the time a motion is made. Are there other questions, comments?
I'll throw in just 2 cents for the elm tree. I don't care what it takes. I'm sort of in this business myself, and a lot of times drawings have all the right things on them, and you go to the job site, and there's materials piled all over the things that are not supposed to be there. Whatever it takes to preserve that elm tree, and I think one of the best recommendations the tree warden has made is to determine the condition of it as it exists now and see if there's anything that has to be done in order to maintain that existing condition. But 20 feet of sidewalk is of little value compared to the value of that elm tree, and whatever it takes to get around those roots, I think, is something that if you work in the field and look at that, I even hate to think of the notion of putting any type of fill, whether it's granular or whatever is said will work. I just think if you can stay out of that root system altogether, it's really important because it is such a unique tree.
We'll do our best to protect it.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Seeing and hearing none, do I have a motion from the planning board? What do you feel like reading tonight?
I can attempt it, but I think I need some help on conditions and perhaps adding an additional one we talked about on another meeting.
As I mentioned before, not to interrupt you, but take your time, and I think the rest of the planning board members need to take their time, and we'll take time after it's read to make sure that we remember it. Like I mentioned, we don't always approach things in this manner, and when a number of conditions are possible, we want to make sure that they're all our ducks are in line. Go ahead, Jerry.
Mr. Vice Chairman, I'd like to suggest the following findings of fact. 1, the applicant wishes to construct a 60-unit congregate care facility located on Scott Dyer Road. 2, this development requires site plan review under Section 19.2.9 and review under the Housing for the Elderly provision, Section 19.3.15. The application was certified as complete at the regular November 20th, 1990 meeting of the Planning Board. 4, the project includes a fire lane which must be able to support fire equipment and be passable year-round. 5,
The applicant is providing the town with sidewalk, drainage, and pedestrian easements, which must be in acceptable legal form to protect the interests of the town of Cape Elizabeth. 6. The development design, as depicted on the plans, must not adversely impact adjacent areas. 7. A 24-inch elm tree, which is a significant natural resource to the town, will be impacted by the proposed development. 8. The applicant has substantially addressed the standards of the site plan regulations and the housing for the elderly provisions. Decision, be it ordered that the request of First Atlantic Corporation for site plan approval of Elizabeth Heights, a 60-unit congregate care facility located on Scott Dyer Road, be granted according to Section 19.29, 19.315, and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. 1. That the proposed fire lane be constructed in a manner acceptable to the fire chief and have his approval before construction. We'll need help on that. 2, that all easement language be reviewed and approved by the town attorney, town planner, and if we could say land use. May I ask the name of the commission?
Conservation Commission.
3, that the plans be revised to address the items identified by the town engineer under the headings water supply, roadways, parking, and Scott Dyer Road sidewalk in the attached letter. 4, that the recommendations of the tree warden be incorporated in the plans. 5, the proposed Elizabeth Heights congregate care facility shall be restricted to occupancy by elderly households. This restriction shall be included in every resident's written agreement by which residents occupy the units in the facility. 6, the street lights along the access drive shall be placed on a timer. I would suggest some specific time entered there. I need help on that. And one I'll make, because it was mentioned before and the board members might want to throw this out, is that a bond be required to be posted in the amount equivalent to the landscaping costs along the Elizabeth Park properties to ensure that such landscaping be completed when the project is completed. That's my motion.
Any clarification needed for other planning board members? Should I say, do I hear a second first?
Second.
Thank you, Janet.
Steve, I'm not voting on this, but I just got a question. On the item number 7, findings of fact, is it 24-inch elm tree, is it normal just to assume that's the diameter?
Yeah.
Most people understand that to be the diameter.
That's correct. You could put 24-inch caliper.
Okay, well, 24, just the way it's written is adequate to define the tree.
Diameter, chest height, whatever.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, just as long as it's adequate to define the tree.
Does the board want to further identify that? Okay. I had just one question or clarification in the first condition that you read, Judy. The proposed fire lane, you said, be constructed. I guess, and I lost track there. Was it with a material acceptable? I would ask the rest of the board if we should include with the fire chief, the town engineer.
Okay. But I didn't say town engineer, so if that's appropriate, I have no objection.
Should we include the...
Depends on whether he wants asphalt or grass.
He's the guy that wants asphalt.
I'm willing to keep it the way you were thinking.
So.
Acceptable to the fire chief. Approved and accepted by the fire chief.
Okay.
Could I ask... I wasn't particularly impressed by their going further than just bituminous concrete and put in something that was aesthetically very pleasing, such as pavers, whereas they had originally wanted to go with just the grassed over, hard, whatever you call it. Do we anticipate any problem with everybody wanting to have absolutely positively bituminous concrete? Do you think they're just looking for something hard for the fire trucks, or are they just...
The mention was made by the applicant that there were a number of decks and it would be visually apparent.
Oh,
to
I know,
the,
and
the
I'm
occupant.
Just afraid of. I really like the idea of having. I like the idea of having it paved, but I really particularly like the idea of having it done with the pavers,
like turf
vis-a-vis
or something, yeah.
Hot top, which is can be. I'm just afraid that. I'm just afraid that he's going to insist on blacktop.
I think what we're looking for is a balance visually, what's visually apparent and what is considered to be safe and acceptable to the fire chief for access. The applicant has a suggestion.
Right. I've had a conversation with Mr. Webster, and those grid pavers are acceptable. What the proposal to him will be is part of it in bituminous because it's a good surface to walk on and stroll on. We do know we'll have people walking around that end. It would be part of part of their activities. But to keep it to a minimal dimension by use of these grass grid pavers to make up the rest of the 18 feet. The problem is that it's got to be 18 feet wide, and that's a big dimension.
Mm.
No, but if it was a 10-foot lane and flankers on either side of these grid pavers, you'd reduce the impact of the bituminous, yet you'd still have a serviceable lane around it. And I think we'll come to an agreement there. I proposed it to him on the telephone, and it seemed fairly acceptable to him.
The board feel comfortable with the phrase paving materials acceptable, approved and acceptable to by the fire chief?
Okay.
Any other questions? It seemed to, perhaps I'll ask the planner if it was clear enough to you on the street lights to be time. It sort of fell away, and perhaps we can help Judy with the motion there. The intent, I think, was to have them timed appropriately for the neighborhood.
That's correct.
Is there a standard time that you would want them turned off? I didn't know.
I could suggest any times that we want to discuss, whether it's 1 a.m. or 12:30 a.m. or 11:30 a.m. I think the intent is that they won't be on all night long, with the exception of perhaps one at the intersection for safety purposes.
So generic language about being on a timer would be adequate?
I think it would be.
Tricia, the seventh issue, item of or condition, said that a bond be required. I believe it's required anyway, is it not?
It is.
Okay.
Yes. There would be a bond required for all of the projects.
Not just the public improvements. That's not considered a public improvement,
no,
is it?
As far as I'm aware, it's all of the items that are improvement on the site.
Okay. Is it appropriate for me to make a motion to delete that final recommended?
I think we should have her check it, because in my experience, it's normally public improvements.
Once again, I'm butting in, but I don't think we can be faulted for having too much of a motion.
So. No, that's fine.
Okay.
I was just checking with Alice to make sure it was seconded before we went too much further. I have a short memory. I guess the last question I have is everybody feels comfortable with the six-month occupancy on the parking. Once that becomes part of the plan, there's little we can do to change that that note to the site plan.
I would prefer to have the situation that we have, where there's not enough parking and the owner is faced with a market condition that he has to correct, rather than to have a supermarket parking lot out there that we can't do anything about once it's installed.
Perhaps I'll put our planner on the spot, if you could summarize the motion so that the board can go give a final consideration to it?
Well, I can list through the conditions. Number one was the condition regarding the fire lane, that it be constructed in a manner acceptable to the fire chief and approved prior to construction. Two, that the easement language be reviewed and approved by the town attorney, town planner, and conservation commission. Three, that the plans be revised to address the items identified by the town engineer. Four, that the recommendations of the tree warden be incorporated. Five, that the occupancy shall be limited or restricted to elderly households. Six, that street lights shall be placed on a timer, and I'm not aware that there's been any specific time.
What do you think, Janet? Do you think it's appropriate to...
I would just say not greater than 1 a.m., and it can be earlier than that in the discretion of the operator.
Okay.
It seems that it's a sort of a self-governing. I see the lighting as a real safety feature and a feeling of protection for elderly people using that whether or not there is a danger, they may perceive a long road through a field in the dark as being scary, and they would normally, as long as their residents were up and about using it, would keep it lighted. But I don't think that there are people that are going to be out doing. I think they'll want to turn it off, probably. Fairly. I think 1 or 12.
Who? Consensus? 1 o'clock is...
I was trying to pick something that would mean
yeah.
I know. I'm no later than 1 o'clock. 1?
Sounds good.
And number 7 was requirement that the landscaping be bonded. And I haven't located it yet, so I'm going to leave it on.
Okay. Everybody feels comfortable with the letters attached and the items in the letters as a part of the condition to the for the motion?
The one other issue that was raised by the board was regarding the note on the plan that talks about providing additional parking 6 months after occupancy. And I just wanted to clarify that. So you'd like that to be another condition? That note be amended to say 6 months? Okay.
Is there any other questions or comments from the planning board? If not, any questions?
No, I think it was answered. Okay. Thank you.
Then we'll take a vote. All of those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Thank you very much.
Thank
Congratulations.
You very much.
Hopefully your facility will be a great contribution to our town.
We hope so.
Thank you.
Thank you.
At this point in time, we move on to new business, and I enjoyably give back the chair to Ivan Most to finish up the evening.
Thank you once again, Mr. Edsel, for keeping the chair so warm, and good harbingers of things to come, I'm sure, with your ascending to the position as chairman. Under new business, we only have 2 items, I assume. Next item that is up for your consideration is Bluestone Corporation. Is Mr. Leland P. Murray or a representative of Mr. Murray here? Is there a representative of Bluestone Corporation here? He's coming. Okay. Okay. Sorry.
I am L.P. Murray. Requesting a renewal permit for extraction materials in the stone quarry on Sawyer Road, as per last year's requirement.
This is a requirement that you've come to us with for how many years now? Just curious, just for the history?
87.
Is it 87?
I believe, yeah.
I know I've sat through a number of them. Any particular issues that you'd like to make a presentation on?
No.
Okay. Could I just ask the planner if there are any issues that we have on this permit to consider?
You just have a memo before you. I'd just like to point out that the memo you have before you lists a proposed condition of approval. Mr. Merck comes before the board every year. This is an annual permit which has to be renewed, and the proposed motion and conditions that are in front of you are the same that have been passed in previous years.
Doing what? Rock excavation?
How long have you been asking for this permit?
Since 1987. What business? 35 years?
Yes.
I just have one minor question on, we have a list of conditions that I you just said we approve every year, Maureen. Under condition 6, which talks about when the loading of trucks may take place, is the 4:30 p.m. correct, since it's earlier than the 6 p.m.? I didn't know if that was a typo.
That's the way it was listed in last year's motion for approval. Do you...
Where
I'm on number 6.
Page 3, number 6.
Perhaps the applicant could answer why it's 4:30.
I don't have that agenda in front of me. You were supposed to get that to me, Ms. O'Mara.
Mr. Murray, what I'm looking at is at one of the conditions of approval I understand you've had every year states no machinery or equipment shall be operated before 9 a.m. or after 6 p.m. or on any day, except that loading of trucks may take place between 7:30 a.m. and 4:30 p.m. Is it typical that your trucks would be loaded by 4:30 p.m.?
Mm-hmm.
It is, so you wouldn't, it doesn't usually go until 6 p.m.?
No.
Okay, thank you.
I believe we have an ordinance in town for 5 o'clock now. Mm-hmm. Construction.
Okay, thank you.
And as far as the 9 a.m., I believe that's drilling and blasting, not... the operation of drilling.
Any other questions of this applicant?
Yes. This is really just a typical year-to-year renewal sort of thing that we're looking at here. That's what I've heard. And that's my understanding. Question, it says a fence at least 3 feet in height. Does any of that fence go along the actual rock face of the... I have to admit, I haven't seen your site, so I'm not familiar with it.
It's completely fenced with a minimum of a 4-foot fence all the way around, all four sides.
Okay, I was just going to say, because in most cases, most ordinances require something at least 3.5 feet high if the drop is greater than a certain height. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to be sure that the town wasn't promoting a fence height as part of this approval that's not consistent with standard practice.
No, it's fenced all the way around, and there's... The gate's locked.
Now, the drawing that you have given us show the blasting that has occurred during the past year?
Yeah, this occurred in 1990.
Okay.
I believe it was September.
But you're not submitting a plan that indicates where you want to blast in 1991?
No.
No. Seems very unusual to me that we're being asked to approve something after it's done rather than before. I'm not, that's only a comment. I'm not suggesting that it be done any other way. The other question I had is that there was some comment about notification of abutters. Do you, as standard operating procedure, notify all of the abutters prior to blasting?
Oh, every time. Anybody within 500 feet is notified. Seismographs put on the property,
yeah.
And they're told when we're going to blast, and they're told when we're done.
Have you done any photographic surveys of properties?
Everything's videotaped.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. No further questions.
Any other questions? It sounds like we're ready to at least entertain a motion at this point in time. Do I hear one? Anybody want to read?
I'll take a stab at it.
You want to take a stab at reading?
Okay. That the board consider the finding of the fact, number one, the applicant operates Bluestone Quarry located at 1019 Sawyer Road. Number two, this facility requires a special permit to remove earth materials under section 19-3-8. Number three, the facility will conduct blasting transport operations
that could endanger the public health, safety, and welfare. Number four, the applicant has substantially addressed the requirements needed for issuance of a special permit for removal of earth materials. Be it ordered that the application of Leland Murray for a special permit for removal of earth materials be granted by the Planning Board for a one-year period beginning January 23rd, 1991, and ending with the regular January 1992 meeting of the Planning Board in accordance to Section 19-3-8 of the Zoning Ordinance and the facts presented subject to the following conditions. Number one, the applicant should keep accurate records of any and all blasting operations, including the times and dates of such operations and the information on size and placement of all charges. Number two, all blasting shall be performed by or under the direct personal supervision of a person qualified and experienced and regularly engaged in such work. It shall be done in a manner which will not endanger the health or safety of any person or damage any real or personal property on or off the quarry site. Representatives of the applicant shall be present at the time of the blasting operation. Number three, the applicant shall maintain comprehensive general public liability insurance with the coverage not less than $500,000 per person per occurrence for bodily injury or death, not less than $100,000 per occurrence for property damage. The number four, the schedule for blasting and drilling shall be permitted by the applicant to shall be submitted by the applicant to the building inspector at least 7 days prior to the commencement of the work. The schedule should include the name of the drilling or blasting subcontractor who will perform the work and certificate of insurance for such subcontracting. The schedule shall be approved by the building inspector prior to the commencement of the work. Drilling and blasting should be scheduled in more than one half day at a time. No operations shall be conducted at the quarry on Saturdays, Sundays, or holidays, except that stone may be loaded and trucked from the site on Saturdays. Number six, the machinery or equipment shall be operated before 9 a.m. or after 6 p.m. on any day, except loading trucks may take place between 7:30 a.m. and 4:30 p.m. Number seven, fencing appropriate signs shall be maintained. The corporation shall maintain at least 12 signs, three on each side of the property, reading danger, no trespassing. Number eight, Leland Murley shall make a reasonable attempt to notify Cape Elizabeth residents along Sawyer Road and Stillman Street in the vicinity of the quarry prior to any blasting operation. Number nine, no more than 10,000 cubic yards of material should be removed during the term of this permit. Number 10, if the building inspector finds at any time that the health, safety, or welfare of the area, residents, or property is threatened by quarry operations, he or she is authorized and directed to order that all work at the site be suspended immediately and to require that the operations be resumed only after further action by the planning board.
Excellent. Is there a second?
Second.
For the purposes of this vote, I'd like to appoint Ms. Lardner as a voting member at this point. Any further discussion?
I have one more question. Could you tell us how much material you removed in 1990?
Probably 2,500 cubic yards, somewhere in that vicinity.
Okay. Any additional discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, signify by raising your right hand. Opposed? The motion passes unanimously. You have your permit for another year.
Thank you.
Last item of new business, unless something got added while I wasn't here, is an application by Fleet Bank for a site on Old Ocean House Road, 3-lot minor subdivision, application completeness and minor subdivision review. Do we have a representative of Fleet Bank here tonight? Please come to the microphone and identify yourself.
Thank you. My name is Steve Doe. I'm from Sebago Technics, and I'm representing Fleet Bank, the developer of the project, and Eric and Lisa Hansen, the owner of the project. First off, I'd like to make a clarification on the application that I submitted to you. On the application, I did note as Fleet Bank being the owner of the property. That is an incorrect. Eric and Lisa Hansen have purchased the property, and Fleet Bank has entered into an agreement with them that Fleet Bank will be subdividing the property for them and handling the expenses for that. What we're proposing here is a 16-acre lot to be subdivided into two lots, one being acres and the remaining lot being 7 acres. The 7-acre parcel currently has a house on it and a driveway, which was constructed under an old proposal. This project, let me backtrack, this project was before the board a little more than a year ago by Rick Weinshank. And
we actually did a site walk on this one, I believe, didn't we?
I did see some notes on
that. I'm not mistaken, we did a site walk, yeah.
Okay. In that, since then, Mr. Weinshank has foreclosed on the property and Fleet Bank has taken it over. And the proposal you see before you tonight is pretty much identical to the one Mr. Weinshank presented, in that the property lines have maintained the same. The house, the driveway are all in the same location. And what we have done is try to clarify some of the questions the town had at that time when Mr. Weinshank was before the board. There was a list of questions and notes that I had gone through in the town's office, and I'm not sure if all the board members are aware of those, but I tried to address all of those in this application. So I guess at this time, if there are any questions, I'd be willing to answer those. There are Eric and Lisa Henson here and Fleet Bank, as well as their legal attorney.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I want to start because when this application was brought to us by Mr. Weinshank, I had to be recused from that article because of my involvement. I was involved with the Weinshank interests. I manage a department at a local institution and oversee that operation. I asked today if a decision one way or another on this parcel would affect myself in any way, either by bias or the bias decision has to be mine, but by any conflict of interest, and it's my understanding that there would be no conflict of interest. I wanted to bring that out. I have no bias. It has gone past that stage, and I have no interest or bias either way, so I believe I'll stay, unless there's an objection by another member of the board, I'll stay on this decision.
Okay, fine. Before we go off that's fine, Mr. Stretzel. Then I would appoint Thomas Emery as a voting on this one here. Any other questions on the application itself?
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
Is it possible for the applicant to further subdivide the property? I would assume that at some point the gravel driveway might have to be upgraded, but is that in fact a possibility?
I believe any subdivision would have to become, after a 5-year period, there'd be a chance to subdivide, provided that the lots meet the frontage requirement and the size requirements.
Could you describe a little bit why you don't feel that it's necessary to have any additional contour information other than a 20-foot contour interval?
The purpose that I saw, talking with the engineer on the requirement of the 2-foot contours, was primarily to understand the drainage of the site, where the water is flowing, and the 10-foot contour provided that in the site, and given the character of the development being basically just a single-family house, very minimal impervious surface, that the providing the 2-foot contours didn't provide any more information than the 10-foot contour provided.
Any other questions?
One other question. Could you describe the maintenance of the driveway, whose responsibility that is?
I believe I have submitted, actually no, I didn't submit anything on that. There was a description of that. I believe it would be the responsibility of the homeowners on those two lots. That would be an agreement between the two homeowners.
Is that something that the board has asked to have in writing?
Board on that,
Would you please come to the microphone and identify yourself, please?
Hi, I'm Drew Anderson from Murray Pullman Murray. We represent Fleet Bank. I thought I'd just clarify that point on the driveway. The Hansons and Fleet have entered into an agreement called the Common Driveway Agreement, where they've agreed to share the cost of upkeep in the driveway. The plan would be that they just have this one driveway off Old Ocean House Road, which would serve both properties. The driveway would be common for the majority of it, and when it got up to the point here, it would split off to service the two houses. And so that whatever upkeep, maintenance, and repairs that are required in connection with that driveway would be shared by the two homeowners, whether it's Fleet or anybody else. It's a matter of record, so whoever owned would have to share the responsibility. Thank you.
If I may just jump in here. This property has always confused me so much. You've got two lots here, one with a with an existing house on it, and one with a recommended building site shown. The other lot is...
The third lot of the subdivision?
Is the Merrill North Star lot?
That would be this one here, yeah.
Okay. And the others are not part of the subdivision at all?
Right.
Okay. There's no plan, I guess, for any use of that logging road, if I remember correctly. We could walk in the property on that road there.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
There's no planned use of that road.
This logging road?
Yeah.
The way we're looking at using that is we were looking to dedicate a 30-foot strip to Conservation Commission if they decide they need it as a pedestrian access between Route 77 and Old Ocean House Road. And that logging road would serve as a portion of that walking trail that would be on that land. Talking with Maureen, there was some understanding that the Conservation Commission was looking to acquire land at another location near this site and may not have a need for this connection, in which case then I've asked for a waiver on that requirement of that.
Yeah, my feeling on that, and this is only one planning board member speaking, we should look to other points in the town besides the Conservation Commission alone. If the developer is offering a walking access between Route 77 and Ocean House Road, that may serve other purposes besides the Conservation Commission. So I don't think the Conservation Commission saying yay or nay should necessarily say we don't want it, so to speak. We may still want it, and we may still want to keep it in the plans. That's my view. I don't know whether the other board members have any other feeling about it, but Conservation Commission is one commission in town, and I think we, as planning board members, have to look at some other pictures, possibly, that may include other things. So I would say if that easement is still proposed, that that we keep it on at this point in time. It's not being excluded from anything we're considering here, is it? Right now it's shown on the plans, as far as
right,
I see it.
Right now it is shown on the plans, yes.
Okay. Any other comments on this application?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I would agree with you. I think that I'd like to see the easement maintained on the subdivision plan and agree that it's not just the Conservation Committee's yay or nay. Trying to fit together an entire greenbelt picture doesn't happen in a short period of time, and to neglect any possibility of adding this together. It wouldn't be prudent on our part. I guess going back to the contours, just looking at this for a short period of time, we had a couple letters received today, both concerned about the drainage. It is not easy to tell with 20-foot contours, other than that we don't have more than a 20-foot drop in a certain area. And I believe the only actual abutter with a contiguous lot is the Richardson property to the north. Are you aware of any drainage problem along? It would actually be along the logging road location.
Yeah, this project isn't increasing any drainage problems that are currently existing out there.
Okay.
In other words, not worsening the conditions.
Third question I have, and it appears that this property has quite limited frontage on the old Ocean House Road, I think it's... Not Route 77, okay? And that there's an old road. This shows that that's not part of the subject parcel, and that the driveway, having been by there, shoots straight out over the...
Correct.
That parcel. Does the subdivision have an easement across that parcel land? Who owns that piece of
from
land?
Our understanding is that it still has not been abandoned. That used to be the old...
It's owned by the town?
From what I understand, in the research that we've done, we could not find something contradictory to that.
Does the town have any liability issue?
It could be considered part of the town right-of-way, in that any street in town probably has a 50-foot right-of-way, and there are drivers crossing that right-of-way to get to the paved surface of the road. So you could consider that just a much wider piece of right-of-way than normally meets it.
Bigger jump.
Is there any way, has the town looked into that? I know that there's generally a lot of confusion in town about who owns what in terms of the right-of-way width. Is there any way of really documenting that or coming to some agreement?
In my review, I was comfortable with the survey that was submitted showing that as the area, and there was no dispute that was owned by the town, and in treating it as a right-of-way area, there didn't seem to be any problem with that.
For instance, does the town have liability insurance, say somebody is backed over on that section? It's not on this person's ownership or this person's ownership. It's actually by the town.
Right. Again, I would just consider it a part of the right-of-way of Old Ocean House Road.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I'd like to ask Mr. Doe, I'm referring to note number 13 on the subdivision plan that we have, and it indicates that the plan is based on a boundary survey predating January 1985 and quote unquote may or may not meet the current standards.
Okay, what
if
that is.
If it does not, how does it not?
Okay, what that is that really, that's a note that kind of covers the surveyors. It's something that the Registry of Deeds has asked surveyors to put on plans, anything that dates prior to 1985. It's just kind of a cover yourself note that surveyors are required to put on plans.
How, if this plan were not to meet current standards, how would it not meet those standards?
That I'm not really aware of, or what I'm not, I can't answer that question.
Are you proposing, how will the deeds themselves be drafted? Are you proposing to do an updated survey, or is this it and the deed description will be developed from this survey?
It'll be developed from this survey.
And how do you intend to treat the triangular parcel that was just referred to a minute ago? In other words, where will the boundary line be along Old Ocean House Road? Will it be the...
It'll be indicated as this green line on here, which basically we're not counting the Old Ocean House Road as this parcel.
Okay, I guess we... Yes, I was
one more. One last question has to do with the access of lot 18-2. As far as I can tell, although there's a recommended driveway location and recommended building site, and it's a little bit dictated by where there's an acceptable site evaluation, it doesn't appear to be anything that says that they can't access onto Route 77. I might ask our planner if there's anything in the ordinance that would prevent that from happening. I think it's the intent... Or I would say it would be my intent not to allow any further access on the route to 77 from additional lots created. And it appears that that's still a possibility in this site.
As far as I'm aware, there's nothing in the ordinance that would limit them from having access to Route 77. The comprehensive plan does discourage additional access points on there. And I think the plan was drafted to get access off of Old Ocean House Road. It may be appropriate to add a condition to the approval which specifically states that there would be no access from Route 77.
Thank you.
I'd like to get back to Janet's question. I guess I'm a little confused. I don't know what we're signing here, or if in fact we are signing this. If it's not if it doesn't meet current standards. It would seem to me that a current subdivision plan should meet current standards when it's filed with the registry. I'm not an attorney, but it just seems, in all the work that I've been involved in, that's what the surveyor's stamp says. That's what it says for local approval.
Maybe I can kind of clarify this. The Board of Licensures are constantly updating what they need to have on plans. And in 1985, or prior to 1985, there were certain ways you did plans to be recorded. And the plan that we used to make some assumptions on this one were based on plans that were 1985 or earlier.
So, go ahead.
So, now the Board of Licensures has asked that any plan that is being referenced earlier than 1985 have some kind of a disclaimer on it, per se. I'm not a surveyor, but I was just talking with the surveyor who stamped this plan, and that's kind of why he kind of told me about it briefly.
But shouldn't there be a note 14 that says this plan was prepared in accordance with such and such survey standards dated 1990, whatever the current standard is, and have his stamp beside that?
Okay, good. Thank you.
The Registry of Deeds and the Recording Act arrange things at times to try to make things clearer. And this is one of those things that on its face seemed like a good idea, but what you end up with is this really murky language that makes it sound like, well, we have no idea whether this is right or wrong, but we're doing it. Mm-hmm. What, for instance, one of the plans that was used in coming up with this plan was the highway taking for Route 77, which was done in 1962 or 1957 or something, when the State Highway Department went through and literally cut that straight shot from one part of Old Ocean House Road to the other part. The rules for surveying at that time and for recording were not exactly the same way they are now, but you're not going to resurvey Route 77. Mm-hmm. To come up with your westerly border or boundary on that. So they're using that information, as well as probably some other ones that may or may not be a public record, to come up with this survey. It's as good as gold, but they're just simply saying that they've used other surveys which don't meet the same sort of requirements that they have now. And now they have to put it on the plan.
We all
knew that, but no.
I'll go back to that old standby, the subdivision ordinance, and whatever it's required to have for certification on the subdivision ordinance would be more than fine for me.
Thank you for clarifying that for me.
I might also add that this particular project, as I remember it, is a nightmare of how something slipped into becoming a subdivision without anybody knowing it. When the original foreclosing bank foreclosed on two different mortgages, I believe, not realizing that they were adjoining. And sold one property completely without thinking about it to somebody, and another one to someone else, and I believe it was Rick Lone Bank, and he wanted to divide it in half, which not made it a subdivision. They picked it up that it had all at once for some absurd amount of days or minutes been in common ownership in one bank, which threw it then into subdivision approval. And now it's been back and forth, and it's an interesting.
Do we have a clarification on the surveying?
To respond to Mr. Emery's question, under the submission requirements for minor subdivisions, item 6 requires an actual field survey of the boundary lines of the tract, giving complete descriptive data by bearings and distances made and certified by a licensed land surveyor. Corners of the track shall be located on the ground and marked by monuments as herein required, shall be referenced as shown on the plan. The survey plan shall show dimensions and areas of each proposed lot. So it does require that the plan has to be certified by a licensed land surveyor.
Well, the drawing is stamped and signed by a licensed surveyor. I'm not sure that's certification.
but I will leave that up to the town to make that determination. Judy, do you remember at all when you were planner in South Portland, the little sentences that went beside the surveyor's signature?
No, I don't. I just know that in South Portland, they were usually looking for a signed stamp. That's, if they didn't have it, it was no good. If it did, they usually accepted it.
All right. I'll defer it to the planner and the code enforcement officer.
With engineering drawings, is basically stamped, certifies it. But that's just my experience.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just add something. Mr. Emery, I think what you might